Thank you. Not very good. This is not going to be your favourite day's weather for mid-August. It's pretty poor, really. particularly in the south, where it's quite damp as well as cloudy. If you take a look from the satellite view, you'll see the developments overnight aren't terribly promising. So you have a jet stream about this kind of latitude, hence on the cold side of it where we are, it's poor. But on the warm side, it's lovely down over the Med yet again. That's the kind of influence of the jet streams. They tend to divide the globe into sections of good and bad weather. You see this depression sneaking out of Norway. That'll bring a few showers into the far northeast, but the main chunk of weather is over the south. That's the brighter cloud you can see over Ireland, Wales and England. During the night then, these lumpy things came up across Biscay and also across the Channel. They haven't really got on to the mainland. They're just probably going to give a thunderstorm or two over the Channel Isles, but nevertheless, this cloud is providing a fair amount of large spots of rain, but it's sort of intermittent. Further north, this grayscale means the cloud is lower, it's shallow, it's unlikely to rain out of it, and there are breaks in it, so probably southern Scotland will do best today for the weather. This morning's weather chart then split into mainly two areas. In the south here, it's kind of dull, it's wet, there are bursts of moderate rain, there's the odd rumble in the Channel. Further north, it's kind of swatches and wadges of cloud with a few breaks between them. This afternoon, showers getting into the far north. This evening, I think quite a few showers into the far north of Scotland. Meanwhile, a clearance working into Wales, the southwest of England, but this is going to hang around all night, so another sticky, warm, damp night. The winds then today like that. Temperatures this afternoon still really below seasonal norm. The summary then, there you are.
Thank you. 7 o'clock on Monday, the 18th of August. This is BBC's Breakfast Time. Good morning to you. The news headlines. A woman is reported to be seriously ill with rabies this morning in Portsmouth Hospital. She's believed to have been bitten by a dog in Zambia. Four people were killed by an explosion early this morning in the French port of Toulon. Police believe they were planning to carry out a bombing attack. And a Stockport man, Robert Healy, will appear in court this morning, charged with the murders of his wife and stepdaughter. Here's Sue.
Good morning. A woman is seriously ill in an isolation ward in Portsmouth, suffering from suspected rabies. The woman, who was on holiday with her sister in Petersfield, is thought to have contracted the disease in Central Africa, where she lives. In the past 11 years, there have been only 3 deaths from rabies in Britain. In 1975, a man died in London after being bitten by a dog in India. 2 years later, in Bradford, an 11-year-old boy died after being bitten in Pakistan. The most recent rabies fatality was a Gloucestershire woman who died after being bitten in India.
The woman lives in Zambia, where it's understood she was bitten by a dog in Lusaka about 6 weeks ago. Now she's lying in the intensive care unit here at the Queen Alexandra Hospital in Portsmouth, having shown some of the classic signs of rabies. Difficulty with breathing, periods of great terror, and hydrophobia, an intense fear of water. The British health authorities and the medical profession are in a state of constant anxiety about rabies. Apart from these few cases, which are nearly always contracted abroad, the United Kingdom has been free of the disease for the best part of this century. But it's endemic on the continent, marching its way across France at a rate which will bring it to the Channel Coast in the next few years. Strict quarantine regulations for animals brought into the country and severe penalties for anyone caught smuggling in animals may not be enough to keep at bay a dreadful disease for which there is preventative medicine, but no known cure once the symptoms have shown themselves.
French radio reports say 4 people were killed when a car exploded early this morning, setting fire to buildings in the Mediterranean resort of Toulon. Police say the victims may have been preparing a bomb attack when their car, which is thought to have contained explosives, blew up in a marketplace. In central France, a tornado wrecked a campsite near Charite-sur-Loire. One holidaymaker was killed and 14 others were injured. Trees were flattened and cars and caravans turned over. 300 people had to be evacuated. In the United States, Hurricane Charley has caused widespread damage to North Carolina. Thousands of holidaymakers have fled from resort areas. The strong winds whipped up waves to over 10 feet high, and there's been 5 inches of rain during the past few hours. Power lines were brought down and remained in a dangerous state for hours, while engineers struggled to cope with hundreds of emergency calls. Police in Manchester have charged Robert Healy with the murder of his wife and stepdaughter. He'll appear at Stockport Magistrates Court later this morning. The bodies of Greba Healy and her daughter Marie were found in a shallow grave in North Wales on Friday. They'd been missing from their home near Stockport for 2 weeks. Commuters in London may hold the key to the disappearance of Secretary Sarah Lambert. This morning, police are questioning people at South Ealing tube station, where Sarah had arranged to meet the man who'd offered her a job as his assistant. Detectives fear she's been kidnapped. Here's Michael Sullivan again.
South Ealing Underground Station, where Sarah Lambert said she was to meet Mr. Simmons, her new employer, is less than a mile from the employment agency where he first interviewed her. He was, he told the agency, looking for an attractive, personable woman who could entertain important clients and dress well. Sarah had returned to her Ealing flat happy and excited about her new job, telling her flatmate that she'd be meeting clients and making decisions for her new boss when he was away. She telephoned her parents in Wiltshire, saying that she was going with the man for a working weekend at a hotel in Amersham, west of London, and would be back on Tuesday. She's not been seen since. Those who saw Mr. Simmons described this man, whom a detective has said appeared to be very cunning, cold, and calculating. Susan herself said that he was businesslike and a little stern. There are similarities with the description of the mysterious Mr. Kipper, who's believed to have kidnapped a woman estate agent, 25-year-old Susan Lamplew, in West London 19 days ago. But the hairstyles are different, and the police say that although they're making careful comparisons, they cannot say for certain that Mr. Simmons and Mr. Kipper are one and the same.
British relief agencies will be considering today whether to pull their workers out of southern Sudan, where a civilian aircraft was shot down at the weekend. 60 people died, including, it's believed, some German charity workers. Oxfam have yet to decide, but the British Red Cross say their workers will stay in the area, although they've had to suspend relief flights. Alex Kirby reports.
The Red Cross began airlifting food into Wau last week, but had to stop in the face of threats by the rebels, the Sudanese People's Liberation Army, to shoot down any plane overflying their territory. They said the government was using the airlift as cover for an offensive. The day after they issued their warning, a Sudan Airways plane with about 60 people on board was shot down by a missile just after taking off from Malakal on its way to Khartoum. An eyewitness said it disintegrated in a ball of fire several miles beyond the runway. None of those on board is thought to have survived. A report on the official Sudan news agency that the rebels had shot the plane down has not yet been confirmed. But the rebel grip on southern Sudan does appear to be tightening, and the prospect that food will reach the starving seems more remote than ever.
It's now believed that 6 climbers met their deaths near the summit of K2 in Pakistan, and not 5 as thought previously. They were trapped in a blizzard which started at the beginning of this month and lasted 10 days. It's been confirmed that expedition leader Alan Rouse was one of those who died. He was one of Britain's leading mountaineers, but planned to settle down after returning from the Himalayas. 47-year-old Julie Toulis was the other British fatality. This latest attempt to scale the world's second highest mountain also claimed the lives of 2 Italians and 2 Austrians. Opposition parties in Pakistan say that 8 people have been killed and more than 100 injured in clashes with police during 5 days of protests. The demonstrators are calling for the release of their jailed or detained leaders, including Benazir Bhutto. She was arrested at her Karachi home last week in the crackdown against about 1,000 activists. Riots erupted in 40 towns and villages, and government offices and state-owned banks were stormed. Troops were called onto the country's streets for the first time since martial law was lifted in December. They used tear gas, shotgun pellets, and some reports say live ammunition to disperse the rioters. Officials from the Soviet Union and Israel will be sitting down for talks today for the first time in 19 years. A meeting on neutral ground in Helsinki. Both sides are still arguing about the agenda, although the Israelis are determined to discuss Jewish emigration from Russia. Thousands of protesters are this morning expected to try to block the start of the government's search for a new nuclear waste dump. Exploratory drilling is due to start today. The sites are at Killingholme in South Humberside, Fulbeck in Lincolnshire, Elstow in Bedfordshire and Bradwell in Essex. People in all 4 villages have already started campaigns to fight the scheme. They say that despite assurances that the low-level waste will be contained in steel drums and buried in concrete trenches, it will still be a hazard. The search for the new site by the nuclear waste disposal agency NIREX is expected to cost about £10 million and take at least 7 months. And finally, Brighton's Grand Hotel opens for business today for the first time since the IRA bomb blast which killed 5 people at the end of the 1984 Conservative Conference. The explosion wrecked the front of the building and caused damage which seemed irreparable. But now, nearly 2 years later, the hotel has been restored to its former glory. Staff worked throughout the night to put the finishing touches to the £11 million refurbishment programme. The hotel is expecting 30 guests, mostly journalists, to check in today. But if they ask for room 629, where the bomb was planted, it's no longer there. The room has been given a new number, and management are refusing to say just what that is. That's it for the summaries at 7:30. Debbie.
Thank you, Sue. Today in Kathmandu, it's reported that a delegation of former Gurkha soldiers will lobby the British Embassy and the government of Nepal. They want reinstatement or compensation for the 111 Gurkhas who were dismissed from the British Army after a brawl in Hawaii in May. They'd refused to identify those responsible for an assault on their British commanding officer. It's a rather unusual episode in the special relationship between Britain and the Gurkhas. They've served the British Crown for 170 years with their motto, "Better to die than to live a coward." In 2 world wars, they lost 43,000 men and won 26 Victoria Crosses. And more recently, in the Falklands campaign, Gurkha units forced the surrender of 2 companies of Argentine troops. So what could be the consequences for that special relationship? Trevor Fishlock of the Daily Telegraph is just back from Nepal. Good morning, Trevor. Can you explain to us what the Gurkha delegation is now trying to achieve? Because the men haven't lost their pension rights, have they? They're not penniless.
They keep their gratuities also. So in fact, they do go back home with something considerable, because Gurkha pay and allowances make Gurkhas very rich and respected men in a very poor mountain region. What the delegation wants is more. They say that it wasn't our fault, we were wrongly dismissed, and they want either reinstatement, or if they can't get that, some more compensation.
It's a matter of some pride to be a Gurkha soldier. Does that mean now that those men who return to their villages will live in shame, practically?
No, I don't think so. The advice I got while I was in Kathmandu, talking among Gurkha people, Nepalese and so on, was that these men will return with honour. By their own lights, they acted with honour when they felt they were wrongly accused, unjustly treated. They stuck together, they didn't split on their comrades, and so they go back shoulder to shoulder with honour.
Now, you've just returned from Nepal. What was the general feeling there about the way they've been treated by Britain?
Some people think, particularly the educated, the intellectuals you find in Kathmandu, think that they've been treated very roughly. In fact, one of the two newspapers have said this is harsh treatment. But there is a misunderstanding of why they've been dismissed. Many people still seem to think they've been sacked for brawling, for having a drunken brawl, although the reality is that they were sacked, of course, for not helping in an inquiry.
Is it really something that's a mountain being made out of a molehill?
No.
Could it have been resolved in a more diplomatic way?
Oh, certainly. I mean, right from the beginning, it's just been a very unfortunate chapter of accidents. And in fact, out of this whole affair, nobody wins. There's no good to come from it at all. It could have been handled, I think, a little more discreetly. But in the end, it became a matter of discipline. And the British Army, I think, took the view that it's our army. What we say has to go.
Roy Hattersley said, in fact, on this programme last week, I think it was, that, will you raise a question? Perhaps it's time to sever links. Perhaps there's no place in this day and age to have a colonial mercenary army. What do you think of that view?
Don't say that to the Gurkhas. The money that comes from paying the Gurkhas, their pay and allowances, is I think, the second greatest source of income in Nepal. These men love serving in the army. It makes them respected princes in their own localities, and the money actually helps poor people. What they're really worried about is that the link might be severed.
Has the relationship been damaged?
No, I don't think so. I think that when the recruiting starts again in the autumn, you'll find hundreds of young men pouring down from the hills as they've done for 170 years, because it's a wonderful thing for these people to be a Gurkha, and they'll come and they'll want to join up.
Trevor Fisher, thank you for joining us this morning.
Coming up, the men on Mount Kent, the first of our special reports on life in the Falkland Islands. First, here's a look at what's on Breakfast Time tomorrow morning.
On Breakfast Time tomorrow, B.G. Barry Gibb goes bun berrying with a new book for kids. And Mother Makes Four, Angel Erin Geraghty with her triplets and an EastEnders bun. The far-flung Falklanders, we yomp to Weddell for our latest report. Plus, Trivial Pursuits with questionable quizmaster Steve Blackmore. All that and more on Breakfast Time tomorrow from 6.50.
Now, all this week, we'll be looking at life in the Falkland Islands, 8,000 miles away in the South Atlantic. Now, despite the distance they are away, 4 years ago, they dominated our thinking. Since the end of the war, a garrison of 4,000 servicemen and women have been posted there to defend the islands from another attack. I spent 2 weeks on the islands, meeting the people who live there and the soldiers who protect them. First, I went to meet the men of 303 Signal Unit on Mount Kent, a posting far removed from the comforts of Aldershot or the jungles of Belize. To visit the men of 303 Signal Unit, RAF, you have to go a little off the beaten track. This must be one of the most godforsaken postings in the British forces. An hour from Port Stanley by road, and then another hour across country in a vehicle which looks a little like a cross between a caterpillar tractor and a milk float. This is known as a BV, and it cuts a swathe through ice, snow, and several feet of liquid mud. Our destination is Mount Kent. 4 years ago, it was the scene of fierce fighting in the closing stages of the war. Today, it's the first line of defence. It might be just 1,500 feet high, but when you finally make it to the top, you enter a different world. Thank you.
This is one of three major radar stations on the Falkland Islands. 24 hours a day, they watch the skies for hundreds of miles out over the South Atlantic. It's also home for the men who work here for 4 months at a time. In command is Squadron Leader Bob Livingston.
Walking around here, it feels rather like an Arctic equivalent of MASH, to be absolutely honest.
Yes, it's still a disciplined force, however, people have a warped or perhaps a wry sense of humour, and people smile, and it makes life better.
What do you think a young serviceman who comes here early in his career can actually learn from posting here for 4 months?
Well, they can learn, first of all, comradeship. They can learn how to live with other people, work with other people. They can learn that by putting lots of effort in, both professionally and socially, that he'll get lots back, and he will leave here a better, more mature person.
Do you ever get problems with people who find it all very claustrophobic after 4 months up here?
No, not really. I think because you know it's going to be like that, and everyone's in the same boat, that if you find people are getting on top of you, you walk off somewhere, one of the rocks, you sit there quietly for a few minutes, be alone, listen to the silence, and then everything comes back into perspective.
The men live in porter cabins, airlifted to the summit by helicopter. Despite the elegant street names, there's nothing luxurious about the accommodation. Living in a box on top of a mountain is cramped and claustrophobic. And taking a shower here means braving a blizzard with just a towel for protection. For most of the time, the station is shrouded in cloud, and with wind speeds of over 100 miles an hour and almost daily occurrence, the weather is no friend to the men of Mount Kent. To most people, this would sound like hell on earth, but to many of the men here, it's the only place on the Falklands they would want to be. Morale remains bewilderingly high.
You just can't beat it. This is the place.
Well, some people would imagine that with 100 mile an hour winds, blizzards, and the fact that you're sort of miles from anywhere, that it certainly wasn't the place. What makes it tolerable?
We're all together. You know, everybody's got to do their bit. Even the boss does his bit, you know. So we all muck in, just get the job done, you know.
How do you stand up to the weather? Because it is really pretty foul most of the time.
You can't beat the weather, so you might as well join it and, you know.
Some people would think that being stuck on top of Mount Kent's very claustrophobic.
Not really. I've been off it for a couple of days, but I spent most of my time up here on the mountain itself.
By choice?
By choice.
I would have thought that, you know, living and working with people 24 hours a day, you get on each other's nerves an awful lot.
No, not really. Just like one big happy family.
Come on, there must be the odd niggle, mustn't there?
A little bit of friction, but a few beers in the bar and then you're back on square one again.
This is tea time in the Puffin Club. Even on the top of a mountain, the men find ways of amusing themselves. But despite the occasional game of snowballs, the working days are both long and demanding.
You're in a live environment for a start. No exercises. If there is exercises, you just do your bit. But if anything does happen, you don't treat it as an exercise. You just think the real thing is happening.
Something comes, it's for real.
I'm afraid, you know, one of those things here.
We're working 10, 14-hour shifts. We work hard, play hard, I suppose.
The gigantic radar antenna scans the horizon for Argentine aircraft. For as long as the government decide to maintain the defence of the Falkland Islands, it will continue to turn, and Mount Kent will remain in the front line.
You get to go to all the best places, Guy.
And how?
You've another report on tomorrow?
Absolutely. Went to an island called Weddell, which is right in the bottom corner of the Falklands, where there's 7,500 sheep, 5,000 penguins, and 8 people. I went to talk to one of them, find out what life's like there. So, that's tomorrow morning.
Smashing, looking forward to that. And Bob's here now, and it's a lot of sport on this week, isn't it, with the resumption of the football at the weekend?
Football at the end of it, and lots of things in between it. Yes, indeed. Good morning to you. There's a very big week of sport ahead, with the crucial third test match between England and New Zealand starting on Thursday. And Ian Botham is back for that one at the Oval, alongside Graham Gooch, who's retained despite dropping out of the tour party to Australia. And Alan Lamb is also recalled as England attempt to restore their credibility by levelling the series. Lamb's wicket fell to Gooch as Essex beat Northamptonshire by 32 runs and took their top spot in the John Player Special League. Hampshire and Nottinghamshire are close on their heels. Well, as we mentioned, the Football League season kicks off on Saturday, and lining up the Spurs at Aston Villa will be Richard Gough, the 24-year-old Scottish international defender whom Tottenham have signed from Dundee United for £700,000.
Three golfers went into a playoff at the end of the Benson & Hedges Championship at Fulford York. Lee Trevino, Hugh Baiocchi and Mark James. They were all 14 under par. But at the first hole of the sudden death playoff, it was Mark James who won the £30,000 first prize.
Francis there. Oh, he's done it. Great putt by Mark James. And we've seen a couple of those over the years. One that turned down in the Hennessy, one down at St. Elliot years ago. And I think on balance he deserves victory. Well played, Mark James. Also, Hugh Baiocchi and Lee Trevino.
A delighted Mark James in a very stark contrast, really, to the mood of Adrian Morehouse, who lost a gold medal at the World Swimming Championships through disqualification. Adrian actually beat his arch-rival Victor Davis of Canada in the final of the 100 metres breaststroke in Madrid in a time which would have been a world championship record. But his joy did not last for long because he was disqualified for using an illegal butterfly kick at the turn, and that meant Victor Davis took the gold medal.
Obviously I'm very disappointed and very annoyed. I haven't sunk in yet because I know that I'm the world record holder, the world champion. I mean the other guys were even like near half a second close. I mean it wasn't close. And
is there any recourse at all?
Well, I don't know, my coach and myself, my team manager are going to appeal, but we're going to give the medals out in a second, so shit, I don't think I'm going to get any.
From Madrid to Toronto, where Boris Becko warmed up nicely for next week's US Open by winning the final of the Players International Championship against Stefan Edberg. And Martina Navratilova has beaten her great rival Chris Lloyd in straight sets in the final of the Los Angeles Women's Tournament. Finally, let me give you Richard Pittman's racing tip. It's Timlin in the 4:45 at Worcester, Timlin in the 4:45 over the jumps at Worcester, and today's flat meetings are at Windsor this afternoon and at Leicester this evening. Guy.
Thanks very much indeed. Well, by now, those of you who took A-levels this year will know the worst or the best. The results came out last week, and for some, it will mean places at university or polytechnic can be confirmed. But what if you're still not sure of what to do next, even though your results are good? Or if your results are not as good as you had hoped, can you still go on to further education? Well, we'll be having a phone-in later in the programme, and you can call us with all those questions about what you can do now. But here to answer them are Janice Bray, Careers Officer from Durham, and Nick Wellings, co-editor of the student book 1986-87. That's going to be an awful lot of people on the brink of despair, I suspect, watching us this morning. They'd expected two B's and a C and they got nothing.
That's right, Guy.
What's the first thing they should do?
Well, the first thing they do is should stop crying. I think the crying period is probably over now. The results came out, as you say, last week. The weekend, they've had to think things over, and that's the important thing. Get another strategy to try and cope with what you want to do with your life for the next few years.
Right. There's two particular problems I suspect they'll be facing. There's going to be people who failed the lot, who don't have any, and those who didn't get the grades they need to go to the course. Let's take the second one first. If they haven't got the grades, what should they do first?
Well, we saw on the 6 o'clock news on Thursday, haggle, and I've been saying for some time, barter. You've got to badger your way in, you've got to ring up. You can go through clearing, both the UCCA, that's the University Centre of Council on Admissions, and PCAS, which is the Polytechnic Admissions Service, have clearing. If your grades are a little bit lower, then you might be able to go through clearing and get a place. You might just have to shift your course somewhere, you might just have to shift the direction of your course, but you'll probably get a place if your grades are a little bit
lower. So it's get on the phone and sell yourself.
Indeed, yes.
Secretary to admissions tutors and people like that.
No, course tutors.
Course tutors.
Direct to course tutors. Don't go to anyone else. Direct to course tutors.
I wish to speak to the boss.
Yes. If you can't get hold of those, then it's AFEIS, Advanced Further Education Information Service, which you can get in touch with through your local LEA. Education Authority.
Janice, if people have failed all their A-levels, they must now be considering a different course of action. What should their first course of action be?
Well, career services throughout the country are geared up to advise people whatever their results have been. And we've already had a number through the doors in Durham on Thursday and Friday, some of the early birds. Certainly my colleagues, I know I've got lots of people to see this week. The options, a careers officer would aim to discuss all of the options, whether it be change of course, resits, perhaps try and get a job.
Right. Well, if you can't wait for 9 o'clock when you can go around and see your careers advice, you can always phone in to Janice and Nick about what to study and what to do if your results were not so good. So phone us on 01-811-1066. That's 01-811-1066 with your problems if you didn't do so well in your A-levels. Right, weather time now. Any A-levels for the weather today, Francis?
No, it's not a terribly good day. Saturday turned out in most parts to be better than forecast, but I think today is generally too much cloud about, and over southernmost counties of England it's quite wet. There's a jet stream that splits, if you like, this particular area in half. On the warm side, it's going to be sunny and fine. On the cold side of the jet stream, a good deal of cloud. Taking a closer look at it, there's a depression sneaking out of Norway, going to clip into the northeast of Scotland. There's this veil of fairly thick cloud that stretches right across Ireland, Wales and England, and that's where all the rain is at the moment. Over the southernmost counties of England, rain during the night has moved up across the channel. There's the odd rumble sort of passing by, but by and large the thunderstorms ought not to make the main, and they might get to the Channel Isles. Further north, this is quite shallow, quite low cloud. It's got holes in it, you can see upwind, blue bits. So I think Scotland probably doing best today. This morning's weather chart then splits the country in two bits. There's this sort of dull, damp, miserable weather down south here with the odd rumble in the channel. There's all these wadges of fairly shallow cloud bits coming in with a few breaks between them, but mostly dry. This afternoon, showers getting into the far north of Scotland, and that'll be a feature during the evening and tomorrow morning for up in this part of the world. A clearance trying to get into Wales, the West Country maybe, Devon and Cornwall, taking all night to get rid of it. The winds today, well, they're not particularly strong, that's the midday field. Temperatures still below seasonal norm. The summary chart then for today, there you are.
Seriously ill in a Portsmouth hospital, suffering from suspected rabies. The 45-year-old woman, who hasn't been named, had been visiting relatives. It's understood she was bitten by a dog in Zambia about 6 weeks ago. Rabies, a rare disease in Britain, has caused 3 deaths here in the last 11 years. In 1975, a man died in London after being bitten while on holiday in India. 2 years later, an 11-year-old boy died in Bradford after being bitten in Pakistan. And the most recent death was that of a Gloucestershire woman bitten in India. Robert Healy will appear before magistrates in Stockport today, charged with the murder of his wife Greba and stepdaughter Marie. Their bodies were found in a shallow grave in North Wales on Friday, 2 weeks after they disappeared from home. Police searching for Sarah Lambert, the London secretary who disappeared on Friday, will be questioning commuters at South Ealing Tube Station this morning. It was there that Miss Lambert was due to meet a man who had offered her a job as his personal assistant. Police have issued an artist's impression of the man, who told a job agency his name was Jay Simmons. There are similarities with the description of Mr. Kipper, who is thought to have abducted Fulham estate agent Susanna Lamplew, but police are not sure it's the same man. French radio says 4 people were killed when the car they were travelling in exploded in a marketplace at Toulon. It's thought the victims may have been preparing a bomb attack when their car blew up. Famine relief agencies are considering whether to stay in southern Sudan after a civilian airliner was shot down, apparently by rebels of the Sudan People's Liberation Army. All 60 people on board, believed to have included some aid workers, are feared dead. Sudan has now halted all flights to the south, so there's even less chance of food reaching 2 million people facing starvation. It's now believed 6 climbers, including 2 Britons, died near the summit of K2 in Pakistan, the second highest mountain in the world. They were trapped in a 10-day blizzard. It's now been confirmed that expedition leader Alan Rouse was among the dead. Julie Tulis was the other British fatality. That's it, I'll be back at 8 o'clock.
The Stranglers were called the Bad Boys of Rock, whose reputation for outrage was second only to the Sex Pistols. But after 10 years in the business, they seem to have mellowed and buried the ghost of a troubled past. Our guest this morning is Hugh Cornwell, singer and guitarist with the group. We'll be chatting in a moment. But first, let's have a taste of the Stranglers' new single, Nice in Nice, from the video.
Ago, with the local authorities, because they have no habeas corpus in France.
until you can prove that you're innocent, which could take some time if you've been locked in a room.
What exactly happened? You were put in court for inciting people to beat up the hall in which you were playing or something?
Yeah, to destroy concrete. We were accused of inciting people to destroy concrete, which is a very difficult thing to do if you've ever tried it. It all got sorted out.
All the band a number of the bands members of the band have had a run-in with drugs in the past.
I think it's just me, actually.
Just you?
Yeah.
Is that now behind you? Is that now a part of your past?
Oh, totally. You know, it's just something when you have problems with your personality, I think, you have problems fitting in with life, you resort to things like that, I think. There's a lot of people with very good backgrounds involved in it, much more than one would imagine, and so it's got nothing to do with how well off you are or anything like that. It's to do with people having problems fitting in with life. And once you get over those problems, then you have no need, to resort to those things anymore.
Excellent. Good sound advice, I think, to everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming in.
Thanks.
Good luck with the single.
Thanks.
Within about half an hour, up to 1,000 protesters are expected to gather at the entrance to a disused airfield in a quiet corner of Lincolnshire. Fulbeck is one of the four sites around the country to be tested by NIREX, the government nuclear waste agency, so that one can be chosen as a dump for low-level waste. It will be buried in concrete and steel containers there. Today, exploratory drilling is scheduled to start and it will last for 7 months. But the protesters hope to deny the engineers access to the Lincolnshire site. Our reporter, Penny Bustin, has been to see how LAND, LAN, that's Lincolnshire Against Nuclear Dumping, is fighting its corner.
In Lincolnshire, agriculture is just about everybody's business. 80% of the land is under cultivation. It's the nation's grain larder, with machinery and profits reflecting the high-tech 80s. But socially, there's been a conservative attachment to the tradition and regularity of country life. Until now, that is. Small, sleepy communities have been hurtled into the radiation age. And now, protesting is just about everybody's business. In the homes of barristers and farm workers, grannies and teenagers, those against and for nuclear power, there's a unifying anger about plans for the dump. It may be five letters long, but NIREX is a dirty word around here. Amidst ripening crops sits a disused Second World War bomber airfield. Under here, NIREX say they might safely dispose of the nuclear industry's litter, low-level waste, 3 trainloads a week for 50 years. Trying to find anyone who thinks that a good idea, and above all a safe idea, is like playing that other rural game, seeking the needle in the haystack.
We're all very frightened. We're not doing this for pleasure. Yeah. We're very frightened about what's happening here. And if it doesn't happen to us, it will happen to somebody else.
A site of this nature inland is crass stupidity. And we just don't comprehend what the government is thinking about.
We don't have a voice, according to them. They're telling us what we have to put up with and what we have to accept, but nobody's ever asked us.
Thoughts from the Fulbeck Front, a military site blockaded and patrolled by civilians. They're determined to resist what they see as a nuclear invasion. 2 caravans serve as their command post. Social activities in Fulbeck, Brandbruton, Stranglethorpe and a host of tiny hamlets revolve around here. Everyone's on a 24-hour rota and the vans haven't been unmanned since the site was named 5 months ago. All movements around the area are monitored and, if needs be, photographed. A CB can raise immediate help. NIREX engineers have already been stopped by a hastily summoned human chain.
1,000 hut use on 6 till 9.
We do regard ourselves as acting in the national interest. We cannot allow the dump to go to
Head.
We really can't.
NIREX have said that it is in the national interest for them to do the work here. We say it's in the national interest for us to stop them, because a lot of independent scientific reports have come out saying that many years' research needs to be done on the geology of the UK before you can even start to look at suitable sites.
What we are saying to the government through NIREX in those certain terms is they have to do further research on this system of waste disposal. I mean, this system they're proposing here, and at the moment they only have it as a conceptual design, not a proven design which we can genuinely object to. We're saying, do more work.
The issue has brought out a wealth of previously unrealised local talent. Geologists,
geophysicists, engineers and ecologists to add weight to the opposition's case. NIREX have earmarked £3 million for the survey, but a local geologist believes it's a waste of money. The site is unsuitable.
The clay is quite variable, and NIREX say they need a uniform clay. There is evidence from eminent geologists, published evidence, to state that the clay at Fulbeck is more variable than any other part of the country. Naturally, one is surprised that it should have been chosen.
Are you anti-nuclear?
Oh, no, not at all. Certainly the vast majority of the scientific committee are pro-nuclear. They realise that if you have a nuclear industry, there will be waste to be disposed of. But we do not think that that Fulbeck is the right site for that disposal.
The interests of Fulbeck have always concerned the Fain family, who've lived here for 350 years. Julian Fain is a prominent local farmer, JP, and leader of the fight against NIREX.
I think it's very surprising the number of people in this area who would never have thought of being protesting about anything, let alone standing in front of a line of policemen and stopping somebody going on an airfield. But certainly this perhaps adds pressure to our campaign. Perfectly reasonable people are prepared to stand up and be counted for something they feel strongly about.
People matter, and what people say matter, and it's not just a government or a government body that dictate to us to say what will and will not happen in our lives. And of course it's people talking that count.
Fulbeck and Penny Buston reporting there. Now our guest today is the comedian and actor Frankie Howard, a man with a thousand grimaces whose risque humour has entertained us for many years. In fact, his latest part is a role he played 23 years ago. It's the saucy slave Pseudolus in A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, which has just opened in Chichester. Roman comedy has always been a perfect vehicle for Frankie's unique blend of humour and innuendo, like this.
Trouble, trouble, trouble. Trouble, trouble, trouble. Trouble, trouble.
You get the message, something's gone wrong. You get
trouble, trouble, trouble.
Excuse me, but I talk to the gods.
I know not you, I don't mean the gods.
Say, hello, how are you? Are you
well, is the
project,
is the word. Projection, they call it.
Now, we had Hugh Corman from Stranglers on a moment or two ago. Are you a musical man? Have you ever made records?
You wouldn't believe it. My voice is unbelievable. I tell you, the first, I strangled a song once, myself. I was doing, I made a record called Three Little Fishes.
Oh, of course.
And it, do you know how many it sold?
How many?
10.
You're kidding.
I'm not. I tell you why. It was made by Melody Records. And you've never heard of them, have you?
I must admit.
The reason being, they went bankrupt as soon as afterwards he made the song. And it's true. And with the result that they only sold 300 copies because the firm went bankrupt. The BBC, I must say, have one. And with these, a rare example of good taste for the BBC, they play it.
They do.
From time to time. I think they pay a royalty of a penny or something. But I never saw it. Yes. So that was my first big triumph.
Thank you, Auntie Beebe.
Yes.
And thank you for the moment, Frank.
That's a man what can chat, isn't it? It really is. Now, I'll tell you that the Football League kicks off in England this week. And once again, following pre-season violence amongst rival fans, the attention will be focused as much off the pitch as on. But if one man has his way, the good image of football will survive. He's Tony Russell, who has just finished a 2,500-mile walk that took him round all 92 league clubs. His aim was to raise money for the cancer research campaign and also to improve the image of football via an organisation he's founded called Supporters United. Well, Tony finished his walk in style with a lap of honour at the Charity Shield match at Wembley between who else but Liverpool and Everton on Saturday. And this morning he's with us in the studio. First of all, Tony, congratulations, and how are your feet?
My feet are fine. The trainers were really good, no blisters or any problems at all. It's the rest of me that shattered.
So what kind of physical wear and tear did you take? Obviously your feet are going to be pretty
well. Yeah, my knee took a lot of wear and tear, I think, but as I say, the feet are fine, it's the rest of me, I'm doing the rest now.
Now, motivation, what prompted you to take on such a thing, 2,500 miles in the first place?
Two reasons, really. One, I'm a little bit sick and tired of the hammering that football supporters are getting all the time, because we know that 99% of football fans are decent, upright citizens, and I want to draw attention to that fact. Also, I had a very close friend who'd been fighting cancer for 2 years, and I wanted to try and do something to help him.
Now, you went round, and despite that excellent motivation you had, there must have been moments of boredom when you really, all you wanted to do was to go home. Now, what kept you going? You met a few people along the way.
Oh, yeah, some very interesting characters with me. Steve Davis, John Conte, Eric Bristow, people like that. You're right, of course, so 30 miles a day on your own gets very boring indeed. But I was obviously motivated to do it, so I'd never started it otherwise. So it's just a matter of keep going and concentrating on walking.
How much money did you raise?
Well, without actually trying to raise money, because the point is we want the money to come from within football. We've said to all the clubs we've visited, can we come back next season and do a collection? Most of them have said yes, so that's when the real fundraising starts. But without actually trying to raise money, we raised in excess of £2,000, which just by people coming up and thrusting it upon us. Right?
And briefly, before I give people the address and the phone number, they want to pledge any money for cancer research. Ian Botham's dragged you into another scheme, hasn't he?
Yeah, February 88 across the Alps. I'm really looking forward to that. That'll raise a lot of money for the game.
Tony, I'm hoping that we'll have some time to chat with you a little bit later on. I know you've got all kinds of things. Steve Davis's cue that he's given you. But I must remind people, if anyone does want to pledge money to the cancer research campaign, this is the address and phone number for you. It's the Cancer Research Campaign, PO Box 89, Reading RG63LA. And the phone number is 01 400 4080. That's 01 400 4080. Thank you, Tim.
Now, all this week, we'll be looking at life in the Falkland Islands, 8,000 miles away in the South Atlantic. Yet 4 years ago, they dominated our thinking. Since the end of the war, a garrison of 4,000 servicemen and women have been posted there to defend the islands from another attack. I spent 2 weeks on the islands, meeting the people who live there and the soldiers who protect them. First, I went to meet the men of 303 Signals Unit on Mount Kent, a posting far removed from the comforts of Aldershot or the jungles of Belize. To visit the men of 303 Signal Unit, RAF, you have to go a little off the beaten track. This must be one of the most godforsaken postings in the British forces. An hour from Port Stanley by road, and then another hour across country in a vehicle which looks a little like a cross between a caterpillar tractor and a milk float. This is known as a BV, and it cuts a swathe through ice, snow, and several feet of liquid mud. Our destination is Mount Kent. 4 years ago, it was the scene of fierce fighting in the closing stages of the war. Today, it's the first line of defence. It might be just 1,500 feet high, but when you finally make it to the top, you enter a different world.